Then, welcome everybody to today's lecture. So today I will talk about motion planning. And this is the problem of finding a path, obviously, that brings you to your goal location. Of course, there might be different trajectories that you could take. And there might be different objectives that you want to minimize. For example, you could fly for the shortest path directly to the goal. You could have the second shortest path that is obstacle-free, which might already be an advantage, or a path, for example, that has a certain safety margin, and so on. In general, the problem of motion planning means that there is a certain world, an environment in which you have a robot that has certain dynamic properties, you want to compute a sequence of motion commands that brings the robot from its initial configuration to its goal location. And for example, these videos that you might remember from the first week demonstrated really impressively what you can do with a quadrocopter if you have the right, or if you have good motion planning algorithms and good models. For example, this robot here is tilted while it's flying through this window, and you know that this is actually an unstable state of the quadrocopter, so you can only go through if you have the right preparation of the motion to do that. Good. So, what do you think are good performance metrics that you want to optimize while you plan a trajectory? I already mentioned a few. What do you think?
Time and distance.
Time and distance. Very good. Safety. Any other ideas?
Energy costs.
Energy, absolutely. So obviously, yeah, speed and energy is important. Also the planning speed by itself, because sometimes planners take lots of time to compute a very short motion. Sometimes you see that with manipulation robots that do really complicated stuff, but then sometimes it takes really 10 minutes or so to come up with a good plan. And then on the other hand, you have to question, even if the execution speed afterwards is double as long as the optimal plan, it might still pay off because the total time of computing the plan and then executing the plan might be smaller. Safety, of course, also the probability of success and the robustness against disturbances. So, for example, you're never always sure, so you have some uncertainty about your position. Some plans might be more robust to disturbances than in your estimate than others. Good. Sometimes people also call the motion planning problem as the piano movers problem. So in case that you've heard this before, the idea is that you not only need to find a path or a trajectory, but you also have to make sure that you're not in collision with the environment. And especially when you move a piano through a building, then the shape of the piano plays an important role in selecting the appropriate path. Because it also means that you have to rotate then, of course, translate and so on. To find a trajectory. And this is even more complicated, of course, if you have, for example, a car with a trailer, because then the shape changes while you're going and you might be restricted in the motions, so a car can only go forward and backward and maybe turn, but you can't go sideways. So the path that you need to generate to park somewhere might be quite complicated, as you all know. Sometimes it takes, even for humans, then several steps forward and backward. Good. So to look again at the overall architecture, you remembered we've been roughly here previously. So we localized the robot, built a 3D map of the environment, and then used this position to do position control. And today we will look at path planning. So this is called the global planning, where you have a huge map of the environment and where you want to go from start to goal. The local planning problem, where you just locally in your surroundings don't want to collide with anything, where you still want to follow the path that you've computed, but at the same time have to make sure that you don't collide into dynamic obstacles. Good. And then always you have some form of executive, which can, for example, be a state machine that decides when to do what. So you know, at some point you might need to replan or generate a new plan, or you might get stuck somewhere and so on. And there needs to be a small program or a program that that then determines the current state and then can re-trigger certain actions. Good. So today we will look at first at configuration spaces, which is the concept for that is used in motion planning for representing space. Then we will look at roadmaps and random trees. We'll also look at search algorithms. I guess that you will be familiar with some of them, but we'll also have some more advanced algorithms here. Then we'll look at path optimization and replanning. As I said, if you're running into obstacles at some point, how to do replanning efficiently, and at path execution, which then brings us to the local planner or the path tracker. Good. So configuration space is in principle also a space, of course. And in the easiest case, you can think about the configuration space just as the workspace of your robot. So then, for example, you would have to plan in a three-dimensional space, which has 3 degrees of freedom. Or if you make it even easier, if you only plan in a plane, then you would plan in 2D. However, as you've already seen, the orientation of the piano is of course also crucial. So you might want to include that, and then your configuration space already has 4 degrees of freedom. You could also include the full orientation, and then you have 6 degrees of freedom. For solving path planning problems, as in the beginning with the tilted window, you might even need to include velocity, possibly even more. Things like acceleration on the path, and that of course increases the dimensionality of your planning problem. If you're, for example, dealing with a manipulation robot, so a robot that has rotational joints and translational joints, then the configuration space usually refers to the joint angles of the manipulation robot, and typically planning takes place in the space of the joint angles. And of course, there is a mapping between joint angles and the workspace, but it's usually highly nonlinear because you have all kinds of rotations along the arm. So it's not always taking place so people call it the configuration space, and the planning community refers to it as the configuration space, but it can also be related to the workspace, or it could be the same as the workspace, depending on your planning problem. And so this configuration space, or C space as it is called, typically not Cartesian because of the rotations. For example, if you have a robot like this turtle bot here, who of you has seen this robot before? 1, 2. In a lab course, I guess, or so there are certain groups at the TUM that use this for students' projects. It's a really nice robot. It's composed of the Roomba vacuum cleaning robot, and it has a laptop on top and a Kinect, and it has very good support for ROS, and it's a really nice platform. But of course, you have then a 2D position actually, an X and Y direction, and a rotation or an orientation angle. And this means that if you look at the theta plane of the configuration space, you can somewhere along this axis, but in the orientation it goes somewhere from 0 to 2 pi. Of course, as soon as you go further, you rotate further, you come back to the 0 angle. And this is why it's not Cartesian, because it has these cycles. And this might mean, for example, that if you want to go from this configuration to this configuration, and you have an obstacle in between, that you, of course, also can wrap around your configuration space. And this is just something to keep in mind, that sometimes the configuration space has cycles in it. Good. So a little bit of notation. The configuration space can typically be represented by a subspace of R, coming from R to the power of D, where D is the number of dimensions or the degrees of freedoms that you have. A single configuration is then denoted by Q or sometimes by S from this space, it makes typically sense, makes sense to split the configuration space into parts that are accessible for the robot, which are free, and parts that are not, which are called, which is called the obstacle space. And then, of course, these two spaces together form the configuration space and do not intersect. Good. So imagine the following simple environment. We have a point robot, and this is our robot. This is where we want to go. Where are the locations here on this environment or on this map where the robot is allowed to be? Well, in this case, it's pretty easy because the robot can be anywhere here on the white surface and, of course, not in the obstacle. So this would be our free space. This is our obstacle space. And this is one possible configuration for the robot that is valid. Good. Now, of course, robots are not points. So imagine we have a disc-shaped robot. Where can it be? Is the free space still the same as before? Or does it get changed? And if so, how? Yeah, exactly. So of course, the robot can't be now too close to the obstacle. So in principle, you can think of this as if the obstacle gets inflated by the size of the robot. And then by doing that, we again have a point robot. so we transform the shape to the environment, essentially, and that allows us again to think about points in configuration space rather than areas in the workspace. And of course, the larger we make the robot, the larger then the obstacle space gets. Good. This is, I guess, clear. Right? So, and this is also called the Minovsky sum, which just means that you blow up the obstacles by the size of the robot. And this does not only work with disks, but this works in principle also with all kinds of shapes. For example, imagine that you have a weird robot that looks like this triangle here, and an obstacle that is, say, a rectangle. Then you can again slide the robot here along this shape, and in this way obtain this new shape that then corresponds to the obstacle space. So this is our obstacle, and these are all points that are invalid or where the robot would be in collision with the obstacle. This is now just for translation, right? If you would allow the robot to rotate, then you would again get probably something like a disc at the end. Good. Another example, imagine that we have this polygon here as a robot, and we need to find a path that is collision-free. We can use the shape of the robot to inflate all obstacles, and then we can just look for a path that goes through free space. Good. So now, from a mathematical perspective, the basic motion planning problem, this means that we are given an initial configuration from the free space, hopefully, which means that we're not in collision yet, and a configuration for the goal, where we want to go to, and a certain set of configurations that we consider to be free. And then we want to find a continuous path that brings us there. So a path that starts at the beginning and ends at the end, and in between only maps to free configurations, configurations from the free space. Good. And typically, of course, this free space can be a continuous set, and there are different methods to approach this. There are different parts of the planning problem that can be solved in different ways. And so I tried to split it a little bit in the four major components. That's first how to discretize or how to represent the configuration space. Then we'll briefly look at the search algorithms, including A star and Dijkstra. And then we'll look at replanning, and then later on at path tracking. So once you have a path, to do collision-free path tracking on it. Good. So there are two different, substantially different kinds of approaches how to solve the planning problem. And one comes more from a mathematical side, which is called the combinatorial planning, which has certain advantages. For example, that combinatorial planning approaches always find a solution when there is one, which means that they are complete. But they have really large practical problems because they typically require that you represent the world somehow as a polygon, and that's not always efficiently possible depending on how you represent the world or how you represent your map. And it also becomes quickly intractable for higher dimensions. So these methods work really well for 2D. Some of them also work in 3D, but typically as soon as you have rotations in it and weird things, then these methods tend to be in practice unusable. And this is why I decided only to focus today on the sampling-based planning algorithms, which are used a lot in practice and which work and which also scale better to higher dimensions, but have weaker guarantees on the solutions that they find. They might also fail to find a solution if there is, even if there is one. And the advantages, so combinatorial planning approaches have a really dense or complete description of the environment, while sampling-based planning algorithms only do point-wise evaluations of the free space. And this is what makes it so efficient, but it also might mean that we might miss certain configurations or certain paths that bring us to the goal. And I'll show you three really frequently used techniques, which is called the grid decomposition, roadmaps, and random trees. Good. So the idea behind the grid decomposition is, of course, super simple. You just take a regular grid in any dimension. So if you're planning in three dimensions or four dimensions, you just have a really full full grid. And then you would determine the status. So you overlay to your map this grid, and you determine the status of every cell, whether it is free or occupied, which is, of course, super simple, but not very efficient. Do you know why? I mean, why would that not be a good idea for high dimensions? True. Yeah. So this, you might end up with lots of cells, of course, that you have to evaluate. Especially if there is lots of free space, then you would evaluate over and over again, do a really dense sampling of the world. It's also not exact. Can you imagine why? The thing is, there are, of course, cells that are half free and half occupied. And in this representation, you could have a certain state where you say the cell is half free and half occupied, but then you'd have to resample again and so on. But nevertheless, I mean, this is actually probably the most used planning technique and C-space decomposition technique. So the idea is you overlay this grid, and the grid can actually even be relatively sparse. So you not necessarily have to come up with a very small grid where you also discretize your robot position, because your robot position will be continuous somewhere. But you can just say, you know, we have a very large grid of cells that we connect. We build a graph from this, so we have nodes here corresponding to the grid centers and edges that encode the traversability. And then whenever we need to plan a path, we just add additional nodes that we then connect to the nearest neighbors. So say, for example, you want to go from here to here, then you would temporarily add this node to the graph, connect it to its neighbors, also do the same here, and then you could do path planning, or then you could run a graph search algorithm on it. And if you have obstacles, then that would mean that you remove certain nodes, for example, or you remove certain edges, and then you can still do a graph search on this. Good. As you mentioned before, grids do not scale very well to high dimensions. And this is why people then decide or typically use sampling-based approaches that just take random samples from the configuration space and for every sample check whether the sample is in the free space. And if so, they add it to this graph and then potentially add edges in between. This has certain other disadvantages. The good thing is that you get you have a randomized set of sample points from the free space then afterwards. But the disadvantage is that some parts of the configuration space might be sampled more frequently than others. So there might be, so this is a Voronoi diagram here of the sample space. You can see that some of the cells then are relatively large while others are relatively tiny. Of course, there are then mechanisms to distribute it a little bit better or even to do regular sampling again, but that would give you something similar to a grid then at the end. Yeah, and this is, but nevertheless, so based on this, you can construct a roadmap as follows. The idea is you start with a single, the first random sample from configuration space, and you check whether it's you build up this vertex set like this, and then you try to connect vertices by checking whether the line of sight between two vertices is collision free. And you do that to the nearest neighbors around a cell, for example, by just picking the nearest k neighbors or all neighbors that have a certain distance to it. The certain distance might have the disadvantage that a large cell might be, potentially extremely large, depending on how much you've sampled. So k nearest neighbors always guarantees you that you find at least k nearest neighbors. Good. And you do that, you repeat this until your roadmap contains enough vertices or until you run out of memory. Good. So this means, for example, you would sample a vertex repeatedly, find its neighbors, say now with a radius around it, and then you try to add edges to its neighbors, and you do that by drawing a line in between and then checking at regular intervals, for example, whether or not these points are in collision or not in collision. And you can already see why this might not be optimal, because of course, depending on how large your obstacle is, you might just miss it in this representation. Imagine, for example, you have somewhere a paper wall, you're in Japan, and you're a vacuum cleaning robot, and there is somewhere a really tiny obstacle that you have represented in your map. It might be just not visible to your planning algorithm. Okay, but probabilistic roadmaps scale really well to high-dimensional configuration spaces, and it's used a lot in manipulation planning. They are not complete, as in the sense of the combinatorial planning methods, but they are still probabilistically complete, which means that if you sample long enough, that they would find a solution if there is one, but only, of course, in the limit. As I said, extremely popular, and there are lots of extensions to this. There are certain situations in which it's difficult for probabilistic roadmaps to find connections. If you have small, narrow passages, it might take very long until you find them. And it's obviously not optimal and not complete. So optimality here means that the trajectory that you find is not the shortest one. Right. So even if you find a connection, it's probably not the optimal connection. By the way, so you construct, the idea behind the roadmap is you construct this roadmap once, and then you have a query. Then the robot suddenly is here and wants to go to here. And then you do the same trick as before with the grid decomposition. You connect the initial pose with the graph that you have temporarily. You do the same for the goal, so that would get connected here, this one here, and then you run graph search on top of it. And this path that you get out of it is not the shortest path, and this means it's not optimal, and you're also never sure, you might not find the path even if there is one. Good. An alternative to roadmaps are the so-called random trees, or rapidly exploring random trees, which is also abbreviated as RRT. And the idea here is that, that you grow a tree from the start to the goal location, which again means so you start from One last thing here on the roadmaps. The good thing with the roadmap is that you only have to sample it once, and then you can reuse it for lots of queries. Right. Now, in contrast, the exploring random trees always start from your initial pose to your goal pose, and they are only good for one query. So if you have to replan at some point, then you have to construct the tree again. So the idea is you sample again poses, you try to connect them, and while you go, in this way you generate a tree, and you do that until you hit it's possible to connect to the goal location in its simplest form. So the algorithm is you initialize the tree with the first node, and then you pick a random target location somewhere, There are, of course, lots of different extensions then that make the sampling, pushing the sampling towards the goal or avoiding obstacles on the way and so on. But in the simplest form, you would just pick a random target location, and every now and then you would try to see whether you can already connect to the goal. Then given this target location, you find the closest vertex in the roadmap, and then if possible, you would extend it and add it then to the tree. Can you imagine why picking the goal location every time would not work? Yes? Exactly. Exactly. If you pick the goal location here, then it wouldn't help. Some extensions of rapidly exploring trees, for example, also try to, so if they detect that there is an obstacle in between, they still try to connect it at least as far as they can. So then you would place your node here, for example, and then you would hope that you're already closer to where you want to be. Good. But yeah, exactly. You can't do that because otherwise you would run into obstacles. One extension is also that you can grow it also from the goal location backwards. So instead of only growing the tree from one side, you know, you can do this same thing from both sides. And that roughly heuristically halves your planning time, because then both trees grow towards each other, hopefully. So you do the same thing from here, and then at some point it connects. Can again see this is also not an optimal trajectory, because it's not the shortest one. And it might fail again, even if there are connections. But yeah, RRTs are, again, frequently used in practice because they are really simple to implement and efficient. Here is a problem. Yeah, here the robot wants to go from here to here, and then these tree grows. There are nice animations sometimes that you can see, and then the robot would follow this trajectory. But of course, the path always looks a little bit weird, and that holds both for the roadmaps as well as for the random trees. So this path, you know, is has a really strange shape, and this is just what comes out of these probabilistic algorithms. You can post-process it afterwards. Yes. Ah, true. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Exactly. We'll look later on how to do that. But in principle, the first pass that comes out of it, and sometimes just people execute these passes, looks really weird. And sometimes if you see a robot doing a weird motion, then probably it's just because they exactly execute this trajectory. And you can also do that with more complicated shapes where you consider rotation. For the sampling algorithm, it doesn't really matter how high dimensional everything is. Good. And one advantage also is that these randomized trees are really good for non-holonomic robots, that are robots that can't go in all directions at the same time. So, for example, if you have a car, then it can only go forward and left, forward and right, and maybe the same for backward. And this is something that you can really easily encode in the rapidly exploring random tree, because whenever you So your sampling algorithm would then say you first pick a node in the tree that you already have, and then you try to execute one of these actions, you know, go forward, left, right, and so on. And in this way, you would extend your tree until it reaches the goal. And then you get, for example, for a car, these nice shapes here where it goes left and right and so on. You know, in principle, the quadrocopter can, of course, go in all directions at the same time, but it still has some limitations in terms of velocity and accelerations. And then you, in the higher, you know, in these dimensions, you might also have a similar behavior. You can't suddenly accelerate or brake. Yes? It's always from the configuration space. And whatever you choose as your configuration space, it might be a pose or a position. Of course. I mean, if you have some weird actions where you say, for example, if my steering angle is larger than something and my speed is higher than something, then I'll start to slide. Then you could also include that in your dynamic model. And then the random tree could plan with this. So people are also doing slide planning with cars, for example. I've seen videos from Stanford where they try to park a car actually using sliding. but then the dynamic model is usually so inaccurate that you need some kind of reinforcement learning or something to adapt really to your car and to the street and so on. But in principle, yes. I mean, this can be anything. It's not, these planning algorithms are so general that they work essentially on all kinds of robots and actions that you might have. Well, and this is configuration space planning, for example, because you have the position, 2D position, and 1D orientation. But yeah, it could be even higher dimensional. Good. So I'll briefly show an example from Freiburg. Actually, this is a colleague of mine who they built a blimp, Zeppelin in German. Which also flies, of course, which has certain advantages. For example, it almost needs no power in comparison to a quadrocopter. And it's intrinsically safe because it weighs super little. But it's really hard to steer, even if you have a remote control. That's always a good test. If you can't fly it manually easily, then probably also your algorithm will have a hard time. It has 3 degrees of freedom control because it has two propellers that it can turn, and it can change the speeds of both of these motors. So these make the 3 degrees of freedom. But of course, it also operates in four degrees of freedom if you don't consider the pitch and roll angle. And because it's so large, it's heavily subject to drift. So if you have, even in a room, a small motion of the air, then the blimp will be pulled along. And of course, also the blimp by itself moves already the air. So if you fly forward and you can't really brake, you know, you're moving along with the whole air around you. And this means that you need to do some kinodynamic motion planning. And Jörg used for this actually two planners at the same time. There is a high-level planner that plans in 4D. That's also what people frequently do, to split it into several planner hierarchies. And then rapidly exploring random tree that considers also the velocities of the blimp. And and this is here visualized in this video. Hope that you can see that. Does it run? So this is the blimp in the real world trying to navigate through the store here. The blimp by itself is tracked by an external motion capturing system. So the focus here is again on this motion planning problem. And then you can see here the tree evolving that which you need to make sure that you don't hit the door while you're going. But you can see these strange branches everywhere. And while the blimp is going forward, it replans its trajectory because, of course, it does not exactly, it's not able to follow exactly the trajectory that it was planning. So every now and then it needs to replan that. I think this is a nice visualization to see how it finds there. And in this implementation of the RRTs, it does not sample arbitrarily in all directions, but it samples towards the goal, which is, of course, which makes sense if you have enough free space. Good. The RRTs have quite similar properties. They are also probabilistically complete. You can steer a little bit in which direction you're sampling, and that this means that you can balance between a greedy search towards the goal or a pure exploration in all directions, depending on how much free space and how many obstacles you have. Are also extremely popular and used a lot, especially for cars, for autonomous cars. You're not never really sure when it will find a solution and so on. And it's not optimal, not complete. Good. So to summarize, the sampling-based planners, they are more efficient in most problems. And this is also the reason why they are used in practice a lot. But they are generally not complete and not optimal. Yeah, and there are some some planning problems that are more difficult than others for these algorithms. Good, but as I said before, there are also combinatorial planning algorithms that you can use, but that scale very poorly for more than three dimensions. They are already hard for three dimensions to implement sometimes. Good, so now we'll look at search algorithms. The problem is now that we have a graph with vertices and edges, and these edges might have associated costs that tell us something about the energy or the time that it takes to traverse them. And now we want to find the shortest path between two vertices. I guess that all of you have seen graph search algorithms before. Which ones do you know? Yes? Dijkstra and what? Yes, yeah, that's good. Any other algorithms? Yes? Mm-hmm. True, exactly. So these are probably the first ones that you learn, and then after that it gets extended in all kinds of directions. Good, because the search problem is of course very general, right? Also Google needs good searching algorithms for where you can already, you know, you can already prepare your search. If you have to, if you know that you have to do it very often, then you can save certain trajectories. But the most simple ones are definitely breadth first and depth first. So you can extend from your initial position all nodes at a certain distance and go on and on. It's complete and optimal, at least as long as the action costs are equal. It has very bad properties in terms of time and space requirements. Depth first means that you would start to descend into the tree. You might get stuck, of course, somewhere. If one of these branches is infinitely long, then you never return. It's also not optimal, as long as you're not scanning the whole tree. So at some point you might find a connection, but it might be super long. Time is also very bad. Space in this case is a little bit better because you don't have to save a lot. You just have to save your path that you can backtrack accordingly. But in both cases, this is probably not what you want. And then Dijkstra's algorithm is, you could say, an extension of the breadth-first algorithm with different costs. The idea is that you start out from your initial node and you keep a list of nodes that you have expanded, and you always expand the node in this list that has the smallest accumulated cost, right? So you would always, so it's like breadth-first search, considering the costs. Good. And while this is in general good, if your map is small enough, you can run Dijkstra. It also makes sense for large spaces to look at so-called informed search algorithms, where you use a heuristic, for example, that brings you closer to the goal, ideally. So this means that you have some kind of an evaluation function that tells you how good or how interesting this certain node is for you. And then you would always explore or expand a node first that has the lowest or the highest value. So such an evaluation function is typically composed of the cost that you have accumulated so far from the initial location to the start to and a heuristic function that tells you, that guesses how far the distance to the goal still is. And you're in principle free to choose any heuristic function. Of course, the more you know about your environment, the better you might be able to predict how far the way to go is. But in the simplest case, you could use something like Euclidean distance, for example, as a guess for the distance. The exact choice, of course, is really application specific and environment, or yeah. Depends on your problem. Typically, people use Euclidean distances without considering obstacles because you have not evaluated them at this point. But you could also run Dijkstra, for example, from the goal backwards, and that would give you more exact values. But that, of course, again, costs a lot of time. But you could run it on a reduced scale, for example, to get a relatively accurate heuristic. And this brings us now to the A-star algorithm, which uses such a heuristic that is composed of this cost so far and then the cost to the goal. And for A-star, the heuristic function has to be or may not overestimate the true cost. So whatever you choose to get some optimality guarantees, the heuristic function has to be smaller or equal to the final cost or to the cost, overall cost at the end. And it has to satisfy the triangle equation, of course, otherwise it would not be consistent. And then this A-star algorithm can be proven to be optimal. So it finds the shortest path, and it also minimizes the number of expanded nodes. There is no other algorithm that could expand less nodes and still find the optimal solution. It's complete. So it finds a solution if there is one. Good. So this is how the A-star algorithm works. May I ask, how many of you have seen A-star before? Almost everybody. Okay, then we can go quickly over this. The idea is that you maintain two sets of nodes. One is the so-called open set, where you initially only put your start node in, and closed means that you have already computed or you already know everything about this node that there is. There is a function that that tells you about the cost of all states, and initially you initialize it to plus infinity. Good. While your goal is not yet in the closed set, you do the following. You pick the first vertex from the open set that has the smallest estimated cost so far. And then you insert this vertex to the closed set, so you say this vertex is now done. And then you look at all successors of the state, and you update. This F should be a G. I'll fix this later. So you fix its estimated cost by looking either at the cost that it already got from some from another neighboring state, or the state from or the cost from our current state plus the cost to transition there, going from where we are to the next state, and then we add the state to the open set if it's not yet in there. Good. Just to illustrate it with an example, we want to go from S1 to S6. There are certain costs indicated here by these numbers along the arrows. And we have our heuristic function here indicated with H. And in our case, we just pick the horizontal distance to the goal. So in this case, the heuristic would say we are 3 steps away, 2 steps away, 1 step away, 0. You see this heuristic is consistent and gives a really good guess. And then we initialize the g values to infinity and the g value of the start to 0, because so far we have not accumulated any cost. And now we pick the node, the vertex with the lowest cost so far, because there is only one, we of course pick S1. We expand it and add it to the closed set and update all its successor nodes. So now the S2 gets a cost of 1 and gets added to this open set. And then in the next step, we expand again. So now we expand S2 and its two successor states. So this means that these two successor states here get now get their g value updated, and then we go on. So now S4 has a g value of 3, S3 has a g value of 2. So in this case, you would expand S3 first, and this updates the g value of S5. So now S5 has a value of 5, which is larger than this value, so as the next step we expand this one, and then we find the goal, which has now a g value of 4. So next step we would expand S6, and then we are at the goal, and goal is in the closed set, and we're done. And the advantage now is that we have never had to look at S5 because it had a cost that was larger than the cost of the goal, right? And the larger your graph is, the less cells you actually need to expand. Now, in this toy example, we only saved a single node from looking at it, but the larger it is, and you'll see examples, the more efficient this is. Good. Is this clear to everybody? Yes? Oh, right. Yeah, you're right. This should be, yeah, right. Sorry, I made this yesterday. I made a mistake. This should be 5 then. And then, again, then these two states actually would have the same cost. And then, yeah, right. OK, sorry about this mistake. Good. OK, now let's look a little bit more from an intuitive way of how A star or how this heuristic function works. Imagine we want to go from start to goal, and now imagine that we use the Dijkstra algorithm. How many states or how much of this area here would we have to explore if we would use Dijkstra? Do you have a rough feeling for how this shape would look like? So imagine we start here, all costs are equal of all pixels. How would the space of explored pixels look like? Yes, yeah, actually a circle, right? Because we would go in all directions, expand, and at some point we would hit the goal, and then we're there. But it also means that we expanded in all directions because we were not guided by a heuristic. How does it look like if we use A star instead? And you know, then we have a heuristic. Yes? Almost. It actually looks like this. So it first goes towards the goal, but then it hits the obstacle, and this means that it has to consider everything also a larger cost, which means that it will not only explore here to the left and the right, but everywhere along this trajectory. And because it still can't find a way around it, then it needs to go further or look further and further. And this means, so actually this, I just drew an ellipse. If you really simulate it, I guess it would more look like a bar or something, but at least it would have roughly this shape. So this is the shortest path that we would like to follow using the Euclidean distance. This is what the heuristic tells us. But if we have to deviate so much from this path, then we also have to look at distances of this size along. And then the same also happens then after this obstacle. Because we already deviated from the optimal path for a certain distance, we'll also explore things around this path, which is already better than Dijkstra. But depending on the size of your space, you're exploring lots of unnecessary space. And yeah, and this means that A star can also quickly run out of memory because you have to keep all of these nodes in memory somewhere. And there are algorithms that can do that more efficiently at the cost of giving you a longer trajectory. But as I said before, you know, it's both. You want to minimize the time for planning and the time for execution in principle. And there is now an algorithm called weighted A star that actually modifies this heuristic function here. So it has the cost that we had so far plus epsilon times the heuristic. And this epsilon here has to be or would be larger than 1. And that would favor states that are closer to the goal. Right, that biases the search to states that are closer to the goal. And the effect of that would be that the algorithm would shoot forward into the obstacle, and only then would start here to explore things around it, and at some point would find the way through and then find the goal. And this is no longer optimal, of course, because the path, this is not the shortest path, but still it's at least it is a path that you might find in reasonable time. So the search is, depending on the size of your search space, really magnitudes faster, but it might be longer actually, and it can be shown that it's exactly longer by a factor of epsilon. And this gives rise then to the so-called anytime A star algorithm, where you start with a relatively large epsilon, for example, because in the beginning you just want to get any pass, right? And so you, for example, set it to 2.5, then you expand very few nodes and you find the solution to the goal, right? You only had to look at 13 nodes to generate a trajectory that has 11 moves, and you could start, the robot could start going there, or the robot could switch on its motors. And then you run it again, let's say 1.5, then you already looked at 15 nodes, still find this trajectory, and then only at 1.0 you would find a trajectory that's much shorter. And in this example you would see that it, so you have in principle two options. You could already start to drive towards the goal here, but then of course if you would find that there was a shorter path, it's too late because you're maybe already here. On the other hand, depending on how fast you can drive, maybe you're already here and then it doesn't really matter. Good. So this is a nice video that I found on YouTube in a Pac-Man world, illustrating these different search algorithms. It's just another visualization because I usually find it helpful to have an intuitive understanding of how it goes. So yeah, they have all kinds of algorithms in there, first without obstacles, later with obstacles. So this is Pac-Man, needs to go to the cherry. And if you do breadth first, then of course it would explore all nodes around it. And as we've seen before, it would also explore the nodes behind the robot, which is maybe not necessarily what you want, because now it has to check the whole field to find it. You can also do depth first. As we said, it's not optimal because it stops when it finds the first hit. So here you see that it does some backtracking, which means that you have to save your history to return. But then at some point you might hit the goal and then you would just stop in the simplest version of depth first. Hill climbing is, we didn't look at that, that's more or less a potential field method where you get attracted. Hill climbing does not work very well when you have obstacles, or depending on the type of hill climbing that you do. A star, you've seen A star was relatively efficient. It only had to look at the lower rectangle of nodes, but still it's a whole set of rectangle is still relatively large. And then the same with obstacles, you can see how breadth first covers almost the full map. Depth first might not be efficient. Good. And A star also gets pulled quickly towards the goal. I guess I can skip this. Good. And now we come to the next problem. So while the robot, you can use A star, for example, to quickly find a trajectory from start to goal, but then it might turn out while you're going that there is a new obstacle that you didn't have in the map before. Right? You come somewhere, there's a person standing in your way, or there is something that you did not anticipate, and this means that you have to replan. And then, of course, you can just do A star again, but this is of course not very efficient because A star still is kind of slow. So the question is, can you somehow reuse the information that you already computed in A star to speed up replanning? And this is possible, and there are several extensions of A star called D star, dynamic A star. And there are many variants of this. Actually, this D-star Lite is probably the most popular one at the moment. But even that one got extended. The original D-star was so complicated, actually, that nobody managed to, not so many people managed to actually improve on it. So that's another thing. When you develop an algorithm, you always have to make sure that it's so simple that you can still understand it, also understand its problems. And so these algorithms, if you look at the algorithm pseudocode, it's really hard sometimes to see what will happen, and then that makes it also difficult to come up with proofs on the optimality and so on. But it's D-star Lite. Is relatively easy to understand, and there is lots of theoretical insights about its properties. So the first idea of the star is to invert the search direction. So we are not searching anymore from start to the goal, but we are searching backwards from the goal to the start. And the reason for this is that the goal typically does not move as often as the robot does. So if we start to compute the trajectory from the goal, then even if the robot ends up in a different cell afterwards, we can still reuse all the distances to the goal. Good. And the other thing is that if there is somewhere a change in the map, and this change typically will happen next to the robot, because this is where the robot has its sensors. And this means that we only want to update cells around the robot. And if we would plan, or if we compute the distances from the perspective of the robot, then almost all cells change if it sees an obstacle somewhere around it. Good. So the general idea is that whenever there is a change in the map, you would mark this node in the map as being changed, and then you would have to update all nodes that depend on it. And yeah, and then again, you can run a star on this. So this looks as follows. For the first search, it's actually two times the same problem. So the robot wants to go from the green box to the red box, so it has to evaluate certain cells. And depending on this distance here that you are deviated from your desired path, you also have to scan for alternative routes. Right? So you see again this, it's not an ellipse, this rectangular shape that is typical for a star planning. And now D star has exactly the same behavior. So in both cases, we are planning here from the goal backwards using the heuristic function towards the start. And now the robot drives the first 10 steps or so and then discovers that actually this cell is blocked as opposed to what it assumed in the beginning. And this means now that we have to update all dependent cells. And wait. And this means, at least for D star, that it, of course, only has to update very few cells. I'm actually not sure. This is not backwards A star. Sorry about this. This is normal A star, where we plan from start to goal. And when we replan, of course, we need to, we start again here and plan towards the goal. And this gives us these expanded cells here. And now D star light just has to, first of all, plans in this direction. So it updates this node, marks it as unclean, and it has to update only the cells that depend on the value of the cell. And that are very few cells. OK, sorry, this is not backwards A star. This is normal A star. OK. The good thing is that D star and D star light and its variants are as optimal as A star is. And this means that it's widely used in practice. And for example, the Mars rovers use this for obstacle avoidance on the Mars. Good. There's also a video that demonstrates this a little bit. This is now a Now robot that is that has to plan footsteps. So you have to find a suitable discretization of the space where you can have these individual steps. And then on this graph, you do you run D star, which means that if there is a new obstacle showing up at some point, that you can quickly come up with a new motion plan. So I think this is now first without an obstacle. Yeah, I know if something happens in between. So you see the initial plan took 1 second to compute. And you could say, I mean, 1 second is not long, but also this environment is not very long. And the planning time quickly goes up. And yeah, if you discover that one of the obstacles is differently, you have to replan. But because you already have computed this first part and nothing has changed in here, you don't need to update the values in here. Good. Any questions on A star, D star so far? Good. Good. So one problem of optimal algorithms that find the shortest path is that they usually cut the corners very close because this is then the shortest path. But from a robotic perspective, it's of course not always a good idea to come so close to these obstacles because there might be some uncertainty in your path planning or in your execution. And if you fly too close to a tree, maybe other bad things happen. Yeah, and this means that sometimes you want to have a certain distance from the obstacle if possible. And the other thing is that the trajectories are typically aligned to the grid structure if you have a grid. If you have a roadmap, it will be aligned to the roadmap, obviously. But both are things that make the paths look unnatural. And where the path is actually longer than the shortest path as it should be if you had a continuous space. And as we looked at, actually this is not a problem of D star, but of A star, if there is something blocked underway, then you need to replan. So one problem, as he said, is that the path, so if you want to go from here to here, then the shortest path would really cut here at the obstacle. And that might lead to lots of failures, of course, if you execute that with a robot. And then one easy way to deal with this is to convolve the map with a certain kernel that adds certain costs to the nodes that are close to obstacles, and that hopefully will then lead to you have then a modified evaluation function that will push the robot away from obstacles. So instead of getting a map like this, first of all, you can see here this grid structure. of course, if you have a regular grid, then then your graph is aligned to this grid, and then also the trajectory will be. So you might end up with this trajectory, and it might turn out that these corners here will be a problem. But if you add an additional cost, then you can modify it to find trajectories like these. The other problem is that the paths are aligned to the grid structure, and another way of doing this is to smooth the path afterwards. For example, you can traverse the path and find pairs of nodes that have a direct line of sight, and then replace it directly by a line segment. For example, you could check this, or you would do it incrementally. You start here and here, and you see that it's actually shorter to go directly, and you can do the same for all the nodes. Then, of course, you have to make sure that you're not destroying that you're not getting again close to the obstacles. But in this way, you can repair the path. And the other algorithm that you can do, of course, is to run nonlinear optimization on your path, so that you use A star only to get an initial path that you then optimize afterwards. For example, an A star algorithm might come up with this trajectory where your robot has to drive through a narrow passage, and then A star is really good in finding this. It would go here, turn, go through. But of course, making these turns and stopping costs lots of time. While if you do that in a more continuous fashion, maybe the path length gets longer, but the execution time might reduce. And especially such a continuous optimization gives you typically very nice paths. And people use that a lot for manipulation planning for manipulation robots. So you start out with this very complicated plan, and then you run a map plan optimizer afterwards, and then it does a very nice and short motion. So here are a few questions that I expect to be able to answer. Can you think of, so what is the maximum time, or can we make any guarantees on the maximum time it takes to replan in case of a new obstacle? What do you think? Using this D-star algorithm, in the worst case, how much time does it need? Any ideas? What? But maybe not in seconds, but in comparison to what you had before. Yes? It depends, of course, on the distance to the goal. But in principle, that the answer here is that we can't really have strong guarantees. If you're planning from here to downtown in Munich, if we discover an obstacle here, it might turn out that we have to go a very large detour somewhere, and then replanning takes ages. So, yeah. And so this means that we are not really sure how long it takes, and we can't give hard guarantees in terms of real time on this. And the other thing is, of course, that sometimes you need the robot to be able to quickly react to moving objects. For example, if you are an autonomous car and there is suddenly somebody jumping in front of you, then you also need to quickly adapt the plan. The other question, of course, is whether we really need to replan for every obstacle that we encounter. And in principle, replanning with these stars can take arbitrarily long, depending on your map and your goal in the map. This is bad for a robot that has to react quickly. Also, we want to be able to really quickly respond to moving objects, which means that we need an algorithm that runs in constant time, essentially. And the question, of course, is whether we need to consider every obstacle that we find, because if you go from here to somewhere, maybe some of the changes are not relevant for us or are not too bad. So you could again trade off replanning time with execution time. If you just say, doesn't matter. There might be a shorter path, but it doesn't matter for me. Then only re-trigger planning trigger replanning if it really brings you a substantial, or if you guess that it brings you a substantial advantage. Good. So this means that for the moment we've only looked at the global path planning problem, and now we look at path tracking and collision avoidance. As you've seen before with the blimp, the global planner, it makes sense to split out the planning problem into two or even more different steps. You have a global planner that typically ignores the kinematic and dynamic constraints. It just does planning in 2D or in 3D maybe, which is really fast and easy to do. And then you have a more accurate local planner that deals with all the dynamic constraints that you might have, but only for, say, 1 second or maybe the next 5 seconds. And it also gives you the ability to react to obstacles in real time. Good. So a local planner assumes typically that you are given a path to the goal, possibly specified as a sequence of waypoints, and you might have a range scan of the local vicinity or a local map that you get from your sensors directly. So this is typically also the difference. The local planner directly works on the sensor data, while the global planner works on map data that you have acquired before from somewhere. But so the local planner assumes that you have a local map of your vicinity and the dynamic constraints of your vehicle and some points that you want to follow. And then you need to be able to quickly compute a collision-free, safe, and dynamically feasible path that the robot can actually execute that brings you towards the goal or towards the next waypoint. And there are different approaches. We've seen in the very first lecture the potential fields that just give you at every position a vector, more or less, pulling you into the right direction. You can extend that by PID control, for example, where you just set the next waypoint that also generates in every state in constant time a motor command. And then there's one more advanced approach that considers additionally the obstacle and the dynamic properties a little bit better. But it's closely related. And this is called the dynamic window approach. Good. You might remember this. So you define a potential function that for every point gives you a direction of motion that you want to do, and that hopefully will move your robot towards the goal. And then the obstacles that you see by your sensors might influence this potential field, for example, by producing a repellent force to push away the robot, and the goal will attract the robot, and you might have other potentials that pull the robot forward, for example, or that minimize certain things. It does not, potential fields do not consider the dynamic constraints, and it also suffers from local minima. But it's reasonably easy to implement, and so, of course, this might be one of the first things that you might try out. A related concept in principle are the so-called funnels, where you say that you can. So it might be hard to program a controller that brings you directly, or that keeps you on a longer trajectory. But it might be easy to specify several controllers that can do a small thing. Yeah, right. So for example, one controller might be able to move your robot towards a specific location, or and then you could have a second controller that again brings the robot in from here to here, and so on. And by combining such funnels, you can, by combining these, you can also have, so you have local navigation functions, and by combining them, you can follow a longer path. But actually more important from my perspective is the dynamic window approach, where the idea is that essentially sample or discretize the control space of the robot, which might be, say, three-dimensional, for example, or four-dimensional. So you create a grid representation of that, and for every cell in this grid representation, you compute a cost, and this cost can, for example, be determined by simulating what will happen with the robot, for example, whether or not it will collide with the environment, or whether or not it will be able to do that. So this score can, for example, be based on the proximity of obstacles, or whether or not you are in an obstacle after executing this command, the distance to the goal, and the distance to the path, and for example, the speed of the robot. And then you would just pick the highest scoring control command. And the good thing is that if you have a fixed size of the space that you sample from the control commands, then computing these cores here will also take a fixed time. And this means that this will run in constant time. And so you can do it, you can guarantee that you can do that 20 times a second, or 50 times a second, to ensure that you're collision free. As an example, consider we have a robot that can go forward and turn. So that's a normal wheeled robot. So we have 2 degrees of freedom, turning left and right and moving forward at a certain speed. And then this would be our set of possible speeds that we can send to the robot, 2 degrees of freedom. And now we can evaluate for every of these commands, we can simulate, say, 1 second, for example, of executing this motion, and then see whether or not this would lead to a collision with the environment or not. And then this would mean that if there are certain obstacles around us, then they will show up here on this motor map. And it's actually interesting to note that these obstacles might appear to be very close when you're driving at a high speed, right? Because then increasing the speed further might collide or bring you in collision with the obstacle. But as soon as you're driving slower and slower, So anyway, you get a local map of your obstacles, and where you know whether or not you are in collision or not. And So in instead of evaluating it then over the whole possible space of possible commands, you can, for example, say that you only look at a certain region, which is called the dynamic window, because your robot anyway can't accelerate or decelerate completely to zero. So it's only necessary to look at a small region. But alternatively, if your computer is fast enough, you can make this window as large as your control space is. And then this whole region here is the admissible space. This is what we can actually do, given our dynamic constraints. And in this region, we have to find the command that has the highest score. And then you can come up with different navigation functions that are then essentially composed like a potential field. So you might have one term that tries to maximize the velocity. So we prefer to go as fast as possible. You could have a second time that rewards the alignment to the path. So, for example, you could say that we are actually not interested so much in being exactly on the path, but just going into the same direction. You know, and this could be formulated by a constraint like this, where you say, if the path says we have to go northeast, then whenever we go northeast, we give a high score to this. And there could be a part that favors going towards the next waypoint, for example. And then the combination of all these different potential fields specifies a preference for which action to take. Good. And as I said, this dynamic window can have a fixed size, and this means that you can evaluate it in real time. And then you would just pick the cell that has the maximum and then execute this action. And you can see that some of the cells have really low scores because they are in collision. And then other cells have this more complicated shape depending on the combination of these different potentials. This is a relatively old video already, 15 years, where this was first implemented on a robot. This is, I don't think that this is a B21 robot, but we have a quite similar robot standing in the lab over there. So it's using this dynamic window approach to move through the environment. And it's also possible to include or to deal with obstacles then. So I skip a little bit through this. So later on, they try to disturb the robot by walking. This is actually the robotics lab in Stanford. Let's see. Whoop. Yeah, so even more obstacles. As old as this approach is, it's still used in most robots, actually, as I'll show later. So there are, again, some problems with the dynamic window approach. For example, the dynamic window has, of course, only a limited horizon that it can see. So everything that's outside of this window is not visible. And it might happen that you have to break before you can enter somewhere in a narrow passage, for example, into this door. And of course, your dynamic constraints of the robot don't allow you to break arbitrarily fast. And so it might happen that the dynamic window approach comes up with a path that actually overshoots in front of the entrance. And there are, of course, always ways to tweak that. What do you think? How could you modify the algorithm, or which parameters would you have to modify to make it see the door before it overshoots? I mean, one option, of course, would be to make the it doesn't help to make the window larger because you're limited by the dynamic constraints.
But why? I mean, if you use a bigger window, then it would see earlier that it's not going to make it around the...
Yeah, actually not necessarily, because these are the commands that you can actually achieve. So if you would have to be here, right, you might not get there. But of course, you could limit the maximum velocity of the robot, which makes everything slower. And then you might be able to enter here more easily. You could also do global planning, of course, in the general case, have an intermediate planner that already anticipates that we have to slow down here, and then the dynamic window approach to really move us through. Good. Now, one interesting thing is that, as I said, it's still used a lot, and it's actually also used in ROS, and it's used on the PL2 robot and on all the platforms that use the navigation stack. This is just to give you a few hints on the packages that are used for that. I mean, we haven't used it so far on the AR drone. Maybe some of you will do that for the mini project, but probably not. So there is one meta package called the move base that actually implements the executive, so that talks with every other module and determines what to do. It's actually implemented as a state machine. So whenever it gets a new goal command, it will try to compute a path using a global path planner. In this case, it's Dijkstra. So you see, they're not even using A star, probably because it was kind of hard to implement. So when you look at the wiki page, then they say, yeah, it's programmed in a way that it's easy to extend and so on. But probably for most 2D cards, 2D maps, it's not the computation time doesn't play such a crucial role. But of course, depends on your environment. And and this global planner uses a cost map that that is based on a grid using inflation. So you give the base print to this cost map, and then it inflates the map as we've seen before, and then it gives this cost map to the global planner, and then Dijkstra can compute a path from there. And then there is a second cost map that incorporates the local sensor data. So this global cost map here is based on the global map of the environment that comes from a file typically, or that you compute with gmapping or any SLAM system beforehand. And then from your local sensor data, you construct a local cost map, again with inflation of your base print. Then it runs the dynamic window approach to generate motion commands from there. Good. So this is a video of a small robot using this in ROS. There are, of course, also videos from the PR2, but I think that here it's easier to see what's actually going on. So this is the robot. It wants to go from here to here. This is the global map. The global map is inflated. That's not shown here, to generate the global path. That's the blue line. And then these waypoints along the global path are given to the local planner that then again generates a cost map and inflates the local obstacles that it sees using the Kinect, actually. So this robot here is carrying a Kinect. And you can see these blue things here are the inflated obstacles. Then the dynamic window approach generates motion commands that are then given to the motor controllers. Yeah. And because it's in principle so general, you can use it with any robot. And it might be interesting, of course, to use it once on the AR drone. But you need a good localization in the global map. You need a global map. And you need also sensors to determine obstacles and so on. So now, yeah, there was a person standing in between, which means that the global plan actually gets invalid. So let's see whether it replans. Yeah, now it triggered replanning. That's then done by the executive. So you don't run replanning all the time, but there is some module that determines that the path is blocked. The dynamic window can't find a good solution, and then it triggers replanning and then continues. Good, so that's it for today. So we've looked at roadmaps and probabilistic random trees. We also looked at how to compute efficiently passes between start and goal nodes using different algorithms, how to achieve any time behavior, and how to replan if something changes in the map. And then also we looked at local planners to follow and execute a path in real time. Are there any questions on this? Good. If not, then next week we will again have two guest talks from one guy, Corbinian Schmidt from the DLR, the Deutsches Luft- und Raumfahrtzentrum, and Friedrich Frauendorfer, who is now at TUM, but who was for 5 years or so at ETH in Mark Polyface Group, also working a lot with AR drones and other quadrocopters. So both talks will be really interesting, I guess. Good. Then see you in 2 weeks.